We have an opportunity to be joined here in the flight control room by certainly no stranger to mission control. Derek Hassmann is a flight director. He's also working in the commercial crew program, and he's just been named to be the partner manager for SpaceX, Space Exploration Technologies. And we're real happy to have Derek stop by the front corner of the room instead of back there at the flight console. So welcome, Derek. Great to have you here.
Thanks, Kyle. It's good to be back.
Well, you know, obviously, most people know you as a flight director, but talk a little bit about your background, how you got to NASA and got into this business in the first place.
Sure, you bet. I can do that. Graduated from the University of Texas at Austin in 1988. Worked for a couple of years for General Dynamics in Fort Worth on the F-16 program there. And then I had an opportunity to move to Houston, work for a NASA contractor in 1990. From 1990 to 2000, I was in the Mission Operations Directorate as a flight controller for the International Space Station program. I worked STS-88 on the station side, which was the first first mission to deliver U.S. hardware to the space station. Then I also worked, I finished my flight control career as a flight controller on STS-98, which delivered the Destiny Laboratory.
Right, the laboratory. We've been watching some of that this morning.
Right, and then in 2000, I was fortunate enough to be selected as a flight director. And which is what I've been doing from 2000 to 2012. I was the lead flight director on STS-120, which delivered Node 2, and then STS-134, which delivered the AMS experiment to station, and worked a number of other shuttle assembly missions, and have worked countless shifts in this room over the years between shuttle flights.
Very familiar with this room.
Absolutely. And then in October of last year, I got the opportunity to do a rotation or temporary assignment in the commercial crew program. I guess about 6 months ago, I volunteered to be a member of the evaluation board that was evaluating the proposals that were submitted by the commercial providers for the CCiCap effort.
Right.
So I wrapped that up and came back. That effort was actually at KSC, so I spent about 3 months out at KSC doing the proposal review, and then came back to Houston and was offered the job of partner manager, which I'm very excited about, and I accepted.
Well, which leads us to obviously to your current role with as the partner manager with space. How familiar, obviously, with all the proposal work that you did? You're very familiar with what's going on, but how familiar are you now with SpaceX? You've probably already had some early meetings with those folks, right?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, when I was in the flight director office from 2008 to 2009, I was involved in some of the early planning that we were doing for the cargo missions that SpaceX is supporting. I was actually working with both SpaceX and Orbital, both of whom have contracts to do the cargo resupply to station. So I worked with SpaceX for about a year and a half prior to this commercial crew assignment. Made a number of trips out to Hawthorne to their facility out there. So I had relationships with a number of folks out there and understood a lot about the culture and the capabilities and such, so that helped me in my new role.
So that transition had to be pretty smooth then, because you already had that familiarization from the flight control aspect, right?
Right, that helped a lot. And then, additionally, Garrett Reisman is their program manager for their Dragon Rider program, SpaceX's, and Garrett was, of course, an astronaut. So I worked with Garrett quite a bit in my role as flight director. So I had a previous working relationship with Garrett as well.
So you guys, after this announcement, which came early August, SpaceX was awarded, I think, $440 million as
Correct.
Part of CCiCap.
Correct.
But you've already, as this new core team, talk about the structure of your team now, and you guys just went out there. I don't know if it's a kickoff meeting or how you describe your early stage of getting into the milestone development for CCiCap.
Right. Last week, I actually made a trip out there with my partner integration team management. John Cowart is my deputy for executing the CCiCap milestones or the Space Act Agreement. Cheryl Malloy is my deputy for the certification piece of the effort. So the three of us went out to SpaceX last week, sat down with Garrett Reisman, met a bunch of the other employees, just talked about strategy and the road ahead. Talked about the milestones that we have planned, and just kind of got reacquainted with the facility and the people. And then next week, we'll have our first two milestones. The first milestone, of course, is a kickoff meeting where SpaceX gives a presentation on where they are today, what the status of their Dragon spacecraft is, what the status of their Falcon 9 rocket is. They'll talk about their ground systems and as well as their mission control systems. So just establish a baseline for where we go from there.
I think we probably all know the answer to this, but how valuable is it that SpaceX has already been working on the cargo aspect of this? It's certainly, they've even described the Dragon as, in its early development, was really in their mind. They thought of it as a crew vehicle and, you know, basically are using it as a cargo vehicle. But they have an integrated approach. They have their own rocket. They have their own spacecraft. But how valuable is it that they're already integrated into the space station program with the cargo aspect of this?
And it's a tremendous advantage, a tremendous benefit to SpaceX and also to NASA, because we have the experience of working with them. But, you know, that has been SpaceX's stated goal all along, to eventually fly crewed to space. And they've designed their rocket and their spacecraft to that end. There's going to be a significant amount of modifications and upgrades that have to happen.
Right.
For example, on the spacecraft, when they flew the cargo missions, they didn't have an environmental controller life support system, which obviously is required to support the crew.
Right.
And in general, across their spacecraft and rocket, they didn't necessarily have the amount of design margin, performance margin, redundancy that's going to be required to fly crew. But the fact that they have existing hardware that's built and designed and flight proven, they've got the systems on the ground, they've got trained teams on the ground, all of that's a tremendous benefit for them heading into the ICAP effort.
You talked about the structure, how it's a little, how is it a little different now than it was in terms of the pit team, as they're known, relative to what it was under CCDEV-2, which was the previous Space Act Agreement work?
Yeah, one of the key differences between CCDEV-2 and CCiCap is that for ICAP, we asked for an integrated system. So the proposals had to include a spacecraft, a rocket or launch vehicle, as well as the systems on the ground to do all the ground processing leading up to launch and to do the mission control function on the ground. So we're looking for an integrated system. And in addition to that, the key point of emphasis or focus during ICAP is going to be certification. How does the commercial provider propose to certify their system to prove that it's acceptable and meets all the requirements for a human rating to fly crew into space, which is obviously a much higher bar than exists for cargo.
Right.
So in order to support that, we broke up the deputy position in the way that I described earlier. We've got John Cowart focusing on the execution of the milestones and the day-to-day activities that SpaceX does to execute those milestones. And then we've got another deputy, Cheryl Malloy, to focus on the certification piece. And that's in the 21-month execution of ICAP, that certification is going to be a key area of emphasis that we need to make a lot of progress on in order to support the downstream activities after ICAP.
All right. And risk and certification are two big key words in this program right now. Brent Jett's going to stop by. He's the deputy manager of the commercial crew program. He's going to stop by hopefully tomorrow and fill us in probably in more detail on all of that, because that obviously is a big aspect of the next step in getting to a crew vehicle to be able to travel to the station and support U.S. crew rotation activities, right?
Absolutely. And that, you know, we're doing things a little bit different with these SpaceX agreements in that we don't have the level of control or the level of insight that we would have with a traditional contract. So what we need to do in the context of these Space Act agreements is to identify the key areas of risk, the key areas of risk or perhaps potential challenges down the road where we want to have the most NASA insight, as opposed to penetrating across the board to the same level of detail in all the system. So it's very important to identify risk and areas of open work and areas of significant design challenges as we move forward.
You talked about the early milestones in CCiCap. What are some of the others that are, you've got it laid out across this 21-month period of time that will lead to, I guess leads up to the point of critical design review or right about there, right?
Yes. The way it's set up, SpaceX has a total of 14 milestones. The second to the last milestone is a critical design review. And that's that represents a fairly mature design for the integrated system for the rocket and the spacecraft and all the ground systems. It's basically once you get this critical design review, you're ready to cut metal, so to speak. You're ready to build the configuration-controlled spacecraft and rocket leading toward an eventual launch. Between now and that critical design review, there's a number of other critical milestones. There's a safety review. There's a human certification review, mm-hmm. where SpaceX is going to tell us what they plan to do to certify their system. And there's also two very, very significant test activities that SpaceX plans to conduct. There's a pad abort test in which SpaceX will demonstrate that the rocket and the launch abort system, the spacecraft with the launch abort system is capable of safely taking the spacecraft away from the pad in the case of some significant issue with the rocket. Right. And they will also conduct an in-flight abort test. Well, it'll be a flight-like rocket, flight-like spacecraft with a launch abort system. They'll actually launch the integrated vehicle and then abort the spacecraft as it's going up the hill and during ascent. So two significant test activities that I'm certainly looking forward to.
Well, it's that's a lot of work to do in 21 months the way it's laid out, and I think everybody recognizes that it's going to be a lot of fun to follow along with this and to be part of it, and hopefully we'll be able to bring all of that to the viewers and the public out there. So, Derek Hassmann, we really appreciate you stopping by the console today to update us on this latest steps in the commercial crew program. Derek Hassmann, the Partner Manager for SpaceX for the commercial crew program.